created my slide deck. And that's it. So, right. So, I figured, first of all, my name is Michael, and you can call me Michael. And I figured maybe talk is cheap, and maybe we do some demos instead of long, boring talks, right? If you do have to go early, my business cards are there if you have a question for later. People usually do leave early. My talks are really boring. So that's why we're going to do more demos today, if you don't mind. So I think that works. And that is easy. So I have a connection there. And so we're set. Should we plug this in? I think a nice way to start would be to take a look at the mobile IoT lab, what we have here. There is, I believe, a photo. Let's see if I can find that. There are a few slides. Where is the picture? There it is. So that's kind of what we're looking at, because it's kind of small and hard to see from the back. It is connected to the internet, hence Internet of Things. And thing we'll do now is program the LOL. So I'm just going to do that with my trusty Android device here. First, let's see if it's connected. On. That should help. So that's what we're looking at. Basically, we're trying to make the LED, a lot of LEDs light up, and after we do that, we'll see the networking connection, the stream of packet stream as it leaves the web browser on the phone, and it actually lights up an LED via serial. Cross your fingers. I don't see it happening. We need some luck from the demo gods. That's not so important. I guess now on the second run it should loop. Open.
Nope. I don't.
Third run?
We probably have anything left.
So the whole point is that you do this, you set
this one. Just a couple times.
Is this the last one?
That's what it should send.
Is this the last?
C'est ça, oui. Je voulais savoir s'il y a moyen de mettre deux personnes. C'est possible?
Oui,
c'est ça.
Est-ce qu'ils tiennent
tous sur la même table sur la gauche dans le fond? Ou pas? Ok, ça va. Mais pas de problème. Ok, pas de problème. Merci beaucoup. Donc, est-ce qu'on peut venir à 9h au lieu de 9h30? Pardon. Ok, ça va. Super. Merci. Au revoir.
Woman from the restaurant. The woman from the restaurant. The four. So she said 22
Wi-Fi connection. That's going to the access point. This thing here is serial, right? So something has to control a lot of LEDs, like Arduino, we can use that. That's what I'm using. It's actually attached to the back there.
Yeah.
And that connection, this looks quite complex. Let's draw over here then. We've got a gallery of this could be a Raspberry Pi or anything with a piece of that stack. Here we're connecting over USB, so another serial connection. Switch over here, more IP, there's a P there, and this is kind of what we have here. So if you looked at the description for this session, our magnificent session, it had to do with, has to do with transports, data transports, and protocols, and this is kind of a one diagram of a hypothetical IoT network, right? That's basically one of the experiments that you can demonstrate using the IoT the laboratory that I carry around with me. The next one, I think we can move to, still don't know why this didn't. So let's try that now. That's plugged in. It should be at So this is basically, I'm afraid to touch it. So if you look at that, nice and bright, there's three bulbs. Well, one isn't turned on, unfortunately, and they're Philips Hue bulbs. There are a lot of manufacturers who make actually computers that look like bulbs because they have transmitters and processors inside. LifeX is another, MyLife, I'm sure there's a few more than I know. And the problem with the computers here is that they don't, they get enough power, they get 220 volts, but they're so miniature, the circuitry is so miniature that they can't run a Linux kernel or a TCP IP stack. So as many of you might know, they're running like a mesh networking stack and nothing else. They're just communicating over Zigbee in this case. Others communicate over IPv6 or Bluetooth, but Philips Hue has chosen the Zigbee protocol and data transport. So that's a 2.4 gigahertz protocol. Let's see if this works now. Let's try it again. Success with this. What it's saying there is it's searching for four controllers over IP. Something is telling me this. Okay, it did find it, I guess. So if we change concentration, let's try that. You're also quiet. Let's concentrate even more. Oh, okay, so something happened here, right? So we can change the colors. Yeah, you see that? Yeah, that's basically the app, the very well-natured, well-behaved, and intuitive, beautiful application. We can do it, we can access the API via REST calls and HTTP as well. And that's what I'm trying to show you. And I think this time it's going to work. Maybe it works if I point a laser at it. OS, which has already connected to it. Have any of you seen Firefox OS?
It's dead.
Beware of funky journalists who didn't understand the message. It's not going away. So here's Firefox OS lock screen, and we'll just take the browser there. I believe it's connected already to Wi-Fi. Here. understood you rejecting connections, and I don't know why. That's too bad, because it does serve quite a nice debugging interface where you can send REST commands directly over the interface that it serves from its web server. The controller there,
I see the light bulbs,
not the light bulbs, but it looks like this. So it looks like this. What you see are the three light bulbs. Although all of these technologies are standard. ZigBee, and there's a standard for that that you can read. I think it's expensive, but you can buy it and read it. And then obviously everything from this end and this side is IP. Oops. So everything on that side of this equation is IP. So what we have are just normal IP addresses. You can ping this and everything else is what we're doing before. So you access the system over IP, and then that speaks ZigBee to the various light bulbs. And strangely enough, the controller only connects to one light bulb, I believe, and then they initiate, the master initiates connections to its partners or neighbors, and they do form either a mesh or a partial mesh network over ZigBee. So that's another example of an IP, of an IoT system, different devices working together with different technologies, different data transports, and different protocols, and kind of mixed together, mushed together. And, right. So that was the
bridge. Sorry, from IP to ZigBee.
The bridge is bridging internet protocol with the ZigBee.
What is it? Which bit of hardware is that running?
That's right there.
What is that?
Yeah, and I actually haven't opened it, but I actually don't know what's in there.
The light bulb joint?
Yeah. You want to talk about all joints?
Yes, I want. This is not an open bit of hardware, this one.
No, well, it's smaller than that, so they must have miniaturized it somehow. I wouldn't be surprised if they modified a pubic bone or something like that, and then attached a ZigBee transceiver to it. That's the way I would do it, you know, and then you miniaturize that onto one PCB, and it looks different, but really what you're doing is, the thing is that it's a very low power, so I don't think, I kind of doubt that it has a high performance CPU in there. It doesn't have a Cortex AC7 or A8. It could be something else from ARM. So it's just speculation. And yeah, so that's the kind of second scenario. Let's see. So the third scenario involves beacons, right? So we have three beacons here. I'm actually going to pass them around because I'm always amazed nobody's ever held one in their hands. So we're going to change that today, right? Did it fall down?
No. You want to pass them around?
No. Can you put it back? Because those are, I'll use those for a demo. Right. But you can pass these around if you don't mind. And basically, if you feel courageous, you can open it up and look inside. It's a little hard to open it up. You know, you just have to use your fingernails and hammer and, you know, be careful, but you can do it. So after you open it up, you can see where the battery slides in. These have no battery, so they are turned off. Some models, the newer generation of these, is Glimworm from Netherlands. The newer generation has a dual power management from battery side, 3.3 volts, and then it has a 5 volt intake from a USB cable. So they're very useful, kind of neat, good for museums where you have a place to plug in cables. Right, that one we just got in the lab from Beacon Inside. Really hefty thing with, I think there's standard size batteries in there, so that's another thing that you can do with something. Okay, so take a look at those beacons. what I'm going to do now, is use this Firefox OS device once more. And
connection down.
So basically, and this application. This application there, the physical web, this exists for at least Android and iOS. So you can actually download that right now if you like, because we'll have the chance to fool around with these beacons in the next, 5 minutes? So basically...
Just a question, is Hemant in the room?
Hemant, our next speaker. So, okay, you can carry on.
Okay.
If anyone wants us to stop, just raise a hand. We'll carry on until we're bored.
I mean, they're not bored yet because they're really quiet.
Are you bored?
Okay, great. So look at this. Okay, physical web. What is the physical web? It's basically a Google project. Early on, they developed a new protocol for beacons because Apple had the iBeacon protocol, which basically broadcasts, it looks like MAC addresses, a string of numbers. This is not as useful in some situations where you'd like to have more context, like a real URL. And Google, being the web platform they are, and doing a lot with the web, decided we would have a new standard for beacons that would broadcast not only MAC address type of identifiers, but URLs as well. So basically, that's what we're going to do now, is we're going to read the URLs off of these beacons, which are broadcasting Eddystone, that's the name of the protocol. And by doing that, we can attach the beacons to physical inanimate objects, like even trees, for example, things that are not even electronic at all, and then have some kind of, form some kind of system using beacons. We can discover, yes, this tree is ripe for harvest, cut it down, that one is not, and so on. So there's a lot of use cases for that. Probably should adjust the screen. So I'm just gonna click on that. And this is the part where you have to take my word for it. Actually, well, I can pull one down and then walk over to the device, because I'm supposed to be walking to the beacon, but then you don't see it on the screen, right? So I'm going to put that right on there. And oh, that would be even better if I just did that. But this is what you do when you. Okay, so it's reading the other one as well. I didn't place it far enough from the source, kind of jiggling and going back and forth. The beacon that I did place over there, once I would walk over there, it could be a wall-operated television, right? So this could be a wall that you don't understand anything about, but maybe there's a small sign, maybe in Japanese or some language that you don't understand. You walk to the wall, and you get a notification sent to your telephone, because your telephone has a Bluetooth stack or any mobile device. The beacon is transmitting over Bluetooth, the beacon Eddystone packets, and then that picks it up and you get the notification. And let's try again. And once you get that notification, you have the option of basically clicking or not. So I'm going to say click there, keyless entry panel. Okay, so then we have some kind of, I've just put a static graphic on there, but it could be a web application, something dynamic with JavaScript and so on. And it could be an access control, it could be, if any of you have that application, if you downloaded that, then you're welcome to walk around, because there is there is a beacon on that table there. There's a beacon on this table up here. And because we're running out of time, I would actually just show maybe a few devices. These are the kind of things we're working with in the lab, doing investigation with that there. For example, so this is what how you can make beacons. It's a generic Bluetooth development.
Are we still interested? Another 5 minutes?
Is the next speaker here? Or
no, you have the floor. As long as no one falls asleep, you have the floor.
Yeah, that's too bad for them, isn't it?
The next speaker's not here, right?
Right. So anyway, this is what we've been doing in the lab with beacons and so on. If you take a look at what we just used, what is hanging up on the walls, it's an Estimo beacon. You can't open it because it has no, I mean, it does have a cover, but it's formed onto the base, so it makes it a little more waterproof, I suppose, but it also means you can't replace the battery. So we decided to destroy one because that's what you do, right? We cut open the cover to see what's inside, and it's basically an NRF51. It's this chip that's right here. That chip there, that Nordic Semiconductor, and you can make things with this board. When we run the workshops that take 2 hours, we loan out 30 or 40 of these boards, one to a student or one to every other student, and we basically make beacons with them. So this is a generic development board running on an ARM Cortex M0, so it doesn't have Linux stack, but you can program ARM assembly code, send it over the cloud, compiled on ARM devices, because if they have a web-based framework, so it works in every web browser, you get the binary back from the cloud, and then you can burn that onto these devices, and they start running your code, and then you can do whatever you want. Abuse the Edison standard and make it longer than 14 characters or something like that, or any kind of Bluetooth application you'd like to develop, you can do it with this board. And obviously, once you arrive at a production stage or something like that, you want to miniaturize that, and then you don't need all the things like the Arduino Shield assembly and the power intakes and a bunch of other things. You just need that small little chip and then whatever microcontroller you're going to use for it. Yeah, and I do mention the workshop because that's actually what I submitted, the 2-hour version of this, and I guess it worked out to be 25 minutes, and that was the process that I came at with showing these demonstrations. And basically, we've seen three different things, right? We have seen the, started out with the lot of LEDs. Is this still lit up?
No.
Oh, okay. Anyway, so we started out with that, a serial, a USB, right, with a bunch of nodes in between. And then we went to Zigbee. So we started with serial and cable connected, copper Ethernet connections mostly. We went to Zigbee and started with Wi-Fi over 2.4 gigahertz with a controller that bridged from Zigbee to IP or internet. And then we finished, actually we don't have a diagram before we finished, but we finished with Bluetooth, another 2.4 gigahertz technology that, like someone else said, they're trying to move towards mesh to catch up with the Zigbee and the Z-Wave folks, right? So we have those three models that we finished in 30 minutes. Not flawless, but good enough, I guess.
It's great to see such a diverse representative set of devices.
Can you use the microphone, please? I'm going to repeat the question.
Have you looked at energy harvesting sensors?
Yeah, so the question is if we have taken a look at energy harvesting sensors and actuators. And what that means is a device which requires no battery or solar or anything like that, that works using its own power. So N-Ocean is one manufacturer that comes to mind that we've been using in the lab. This is my partner that does most of the work. So N-Ocean you might want to take a look at. What we've had with those are the clickers. So these emit an RF signal. I'm not sure. I think it's 868 megahertz. And basically, to emit RF, you need energy, right? But they don't have any batteries in there, so how does that work? Well, when your finger pushes down on that button, it's causing motion. And in some way, which I don't understand, maybe you do, it's harvesting that energy and then storing it for a very small amount of time, a capacitor of some kind probably, and then using that to transmit the RF signal. Does that answer your question?
In your first demo, you used MQTT. Where in your scheme do you have the message broker, and what did you use for it?
I think I missed something there, didn't I? Because that's very interesting. Here, there is a broker, and where would that be? So basically, it's on the back. Hard to see, I'm sorry. But the only compute, most of the power that I have on this laboratory is on the back. But there is one exception. See, so this is like power bricks. There's a upstream router. There's one exception. There's one computer on the back there, and that's a Raspberry Pi. So it's kind of I'm just using it for a broker and almost nothing else. That's what's doing all of the MQTT broking for the entire network of computers on the front. And I didn't mention it, but there are two Galileos. So those are Intel IA32 or instruction set computers on the front, similar to Raspberry Pi, but not ARM. There is an Edison as well. It's an extremely small computer, which is low power. It's actually very old, so the newer generations of Intel, similar technology, are incredibly low power. The last I heard, the Curie boards, for example, that are about the size of a button, they discharge power while running about the same as a battery that's held up into the air and discharges from moisture. I'm not sure if I believe that, but so keep your eyes and ears open. And basically, the MQTT broker is on the back, and it looks like this on the diagram. So we have the Galileo there, and the Wi-Fi is here. This is talking.
Is it fixed, the download?
We need to call the guy from the co-location.
Happens often.
Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. Happens
yeah.
Often.
Yeah, so the switch is connecting the MQTT broker to the MQTT client, which is then, you know, reading from a topic or subscribing to a topic, and then whenever it does get a message, it changes the LED context. But they never even put anything in the future. Any other questions?
Well,
I guess I can't make a photo of that. If I had a mirror, I could. So the question is, what is the device that I'm using to do these nifty projections, right? So I can put my hand there, or I have an old pen, or whatever. And the device is a Microsoft webcam. Let's see if I can. I don't even know, Cinema or Studio or something like that. Or Pro. I can't read the model number, and it's mounted on a very sturdy, very well made. Close range. What is the name of this? It's made by Lumitrade and Canobi. Yeah, I can do that. But that won't help you too much because my friend who makes these, his name is Matthias, and he lives in Munich where I live as well. He stopped production. So he may have a few more, but they are quite interesting things. Pretty cool, aren't they? Yeah. So if I do this, what happens? That at the screen. Have an endless loop. Anything else? Anything about Z-Wave maybe that we didn't talk about, or other frequencies or other protocols? I mean, we already had COAP in the morning, we had CMQ.
LoRa network or something. LoRa network, things like that.
Yeah, you see, that would be really neat. And that's kind of the next generation. That's, most people haven't heard of LoRa or Sigfox. These are 868 megahertz transmitters, and usually, I guess you can receive, yeah, the transceivers, you receive and transmit, you need the base station. Anyway, so that's not part of the setup, but that's what we're looking at getting into next, and it uses the same ARM framework as these boards here. So that will be very interesting. It's very easy to program for the stacks, easy to program for the LoRa network as well. LoRa, what does that stand for? Low power, low range. Let's just say low range. That sounds
long range.
Long range.
And what about all the protocols like ELC, X10, Ghost to Moon, are not wireless?
So the question is, what about the data transports actually that are transmitting data over electrical 220 volt standard house connections and building connections? And I guess that does fit quite well as the lighting aspect, Philips Hue and so on. But I don't have anything to contribute with that.
Peter.